Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. My name is Misty Perez-Truedson. I'm the Advocacy and Organizing Director at Free Press. And for those of you that don't know, Free Press is a national nonpartisan nonprofit organization with an office right up the road. We're working to change the media by advancing public interest media and technology policies. We fight for your rights to connect and communicate, and we do so by advocating for universal and affordable internet access, diverse media ownership, vibrant public media, and quality journalism. For far too long, media policies were being made behind closed doors between corporations and politicians without the input of the public. At Free Press, we believe we have to flip the balance of power and ensure that the public has a seat at the table when it comes to setting media policy. I'm proud to say that over the last 10 years, Free Press and our allies have succeeded in ensuring that the policymakers hear from the public on numerous media policy issues. And over the next 10 years, and for as long as it takes to ensure media policies are serving the public good and not simply increasing corporate profits, Free Press will continue to work with our allies in the Valley and across the country to mobilize millions more to stand up for media reform. Robert McChesney and John Nichols, our featured guests here tonight somewhere, they came by the office earlier today and they shared with us their thoughts on where we should be focusing our energy. And I'm happy to agree that we came to the same conclusions. We concluded that we need to spend our time in communities across the country. We need to listen to everyday people, to community leaders, to activists, to academics, to media makers, to organizers, to librarians, to movement leaders, and to thought leaders. And we need to listen to how media policy impacts their lives, and we need to respond with the tools and support necessary to turn their passion into the lobbying power we need to fundamentally change the media system that we have. And we're starting that work, I'm happy to say, right here in our own backyard. Through partnerships with academic institutions and youth in the Valley, we will listen and learn how best to collaborate on campus and off. Through convenings of the Western Massachusetts Media Justice Network, where the opportunities to learn from one another seem endless. Through deeper engagement with many of you who are on our email action list, following us on Twitter, liking us on Facebook, lobbying your elected officials with us, or attending our conferences and events here tonight, and yet are still hungry for more. I promise you there is much more to do. And I'm happy to have Bob and John with us tonight to inspire us to do more, to focus our energy, and to work together right here in the Valley. I'd like to thank all of our co-hosts who are with us here tonight. Thanks to our allies at Amherst Media, the National Priorities Project, Northampton Community Television, Valley Free Radio, the Wiseman Center for Leadership, the Western Massachusetts Media Justice Network, and the Western Massachusetts Progressive Democrats of America. I'd also like to thank the Unitarian Society of Northampton for letting us use this beautiful space. Please be sure to chat with our allies and to check out their literature in the room behind us. Also, if you need to find your way to the restroom, you can go through the room behind us and take the elevator downstairs. At this point, I'd like to turn things over to our dear friend, Martha Fuentes-Bautista. Martha is an assistant professor in the communications department at UMass Amherst, a longtime friend of Free Press, and one of the founding members of the Western Massachusetts Media Justice Network. The Western Massachusetts Media Justice Network is a prime example of what Martha and her colleagues at UMass Amherst do to connect community members and allies in the Valley to each other. I'm grateful for her work, and I'm pleased to have her here with us tonight. Please join me in welcoming Martha.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone, and welcome. It's a pleasure to be with you today. So I guess that, in the last two decades, the work of Robert McChesney and John Nichols has transformed the view of policymaking and make it really a core political issue of our democracy, a site, actually, where we can interrogate the life, the meaning, and the survival of the democracy in this country. But even more important than that, I think that their work issued an urgent call for action some years ago to mobilize and engage the public in debates that actually define the rules that shape our media system, particularly in a period that was very important for us because corporate capitalism was trying to reassert their power and rewrite the rules for, you know, the next century. So we are here tonight because this call for action was first answered 10 years ago here in Western Massachusetts, when a group of media and social activists led by Josh Silver and Kimberly Longy, where are they? Thank you. Actually invited Bob McChesney and Nichols to come to the Valley and to create Free Press to reignite the fight for media reform in this country. And I guess that's something that we all know but probably has to be said, is that over the years, the work of media reformers have drawn tremendous energies and inspiration from a larger pro-democracy and progressive movement that actually thrived here in Western Mass. This movement finds expression not only in the work of many community-based organizations, media organizations here in the Valley, but also in the work of, for instance, electoral campaign reformers, environmental justice organizations, LGBT rights advocates, anti-war groups, organized farmer communities, and so on. So, but something that has been really exciting to see in the, I would say, in the last couple of years, is that even amidst the shock and the pain that the economic crisis have inflicted to our communities, we have grassroots organizations and social advocates and community media turning to each other and coming together and seeking new ways to collaborate even in these difficult times. So in that context, for instance, we have seen new programming and renewed calls to occupy the airways on Valley Free Radio, increased demand for the service of access centers throughout the Valley, and I have to say, finally, a serious push to bring media centers to Holyoke and Springfield that's so much needed. We also have seen the emergence of a Latino press engaged in challenging anti-immigration discourses that are so prevalent in the mainstream media. And we are also delighted with the work of the Youth Action Coalition, for instance, that takes on school budgets and issues of educational reform and other issues that affect the youth and teens in diverse communities across the Valley. So actually it was in 1996 that Robert McChesney wrote that the goal of scholars should be to make a difference, to understand the world so as to change it, and to commit to democratic values. And over the last year, or a little less, actually, I have been honored and delighted to work with my colleagues from UMass Amherst, Professors Mari Castañeda, that is here tonight with us, Dimitri Shabazz, Professor Bernadine Melis from Mount Holyoke and UMass Amherst, in facilitating the creation of this Western Mass Massachusetts Media Justice Network. And I think that is something that was happening, but I would say we were just able to, in a particular moment, bring some of our resources to enable the work of the network. The network is a group of critical media scholars, educators, media makers, activists, policy advocates, and students engaged in feminist media justice work here in the five colleges and surrounding communities. Our goal is to broaden and diversify the work of media justice and media reform, actually by fostering collaboration among projects that interrogate the impacts of structural racism, sexism, politics, and socioeconomic inequalities on our media. So thanks for the support, actually, of a five college public policy initiative. We have one emerging, actually, in last year. The five college Women's Study Research Center, and community partners, actually, like Free Press, Amherst Media, NCTV, and so forth. We have been at meeting and advancing this conversation since last spring. So actually, today, we celebrated our first meeting of the fall at Free Press. We just finished there. And actually, we were delighted because with us today, we had well-known media activist, policy advocacy, Pete Tridish, and he just got here, hi Pete, And we welcome Pete actually as our 5 college social justice practitioner in residence. And today we were actually working with him in pinpointing issues of coalition building for this network. So it's happening. It's just happening. But so in conclusion, media activism and advocacy in the Valley continues to grow, especially in its diversity and openness. And we are committed to connect local experiences to larger federal state issues of a structural reform in the country. We think that a national movement of media reform cannot advance without a network of support of the grassroots. And our commitment is to make that happen in a framework of inclusion and justice. So I guess that the good news that we wanted to share with you tonight was that Western Massachusetts is here today to answer the call again. Thank you.
Thank you, Martha. I hope that if you're interested in joining the Western Massachusetts Media Justice Network, you'll find Martha after and find out how. Okay, sorry about that. Many of you know that 2 of the founders of Free Press, Josh Silver and Kimberly Longhi, are lifelong residents of the Valley. Our current president isn't a lifelong member of the Valley. However, he does understand the importance of us investing in local organizing in the Valley. You're laughing about. He understands. He realizes that investing in local organizing is essential in building the power that we need to hold Washington accountable. And he's here with us tonight, so I'd like to give a warm welcome to our president and CEO, Craig Aaron.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Misty. I often get accused of preaching to the choir. This is more like it. As Misty said, I'm Craig Aaron. I'm the president and CEO of Free Press, and it's nice to be here in Northampton. I do have the, I guess we'll call it misfortune of being located in the nation's capital, although my family's there, so it seems like a wise choice. But for a number of years, Northampton has really been my home away from home. So I want to thank all of our local friends and co-sponsors for help getting the word out about tonight's event. For those of you who've been paying attention, you now know that Free Press is the national nonprofit, nonpartisan organization devoted to advocating for the public on issues surrounding media, technology, and democracy. I'm so glad to be here tonight with 2 of our founders, Bob McChesney and John Nichols, to celebrate the publication of this excellent book, Dollarocracy. I want to let people know that Bob and John are going to be signing copies of Dollarocracy right behind me after the presentations. And I'm getting a lot of feedback. They're not kidding. There's a little sign here that says the microphone is very sensitive. And it is true. So I'm going to stand over here. It wasn't that long ago, although if I think about it, it was probably 15 years ago, that I was sitting in the same spot that many of you are, waiting to hear Bob McChesney and John Nichols speak for the first time. I was a young journalist in Chicago, I was a progressive, and the word I've picked to describe how I felt afterwards was gobsmacked by what they had to say, because McChesney and Nichols really connected the dots for me as someone who cared about media, who cared about democracy, and who was trying to stay positive about what this country and its people could accomplish. They've always had for me this great ability of providing those aha moments, saying the thing that you always knew to be true, only maybe you hadn't thought about it until right at that moment. You will hear a lot of sobering statistics and disturbing history as they talk about what's in this book tonight. You're gonna have your eyes opened to a lot of new things, but I don't think you will leave this conversation feeling helpless or hopeless, because underneath all the bad news that Bob and John sometimes have to share is an unshakable optimism, an unshakable optimism that even in the face of powerful and mendacious opponents, that they have a faith in the power of the people to remake the world. And Bob McChesney and John Nichols have never been afraid to push those big ideas, the big ideas that stretched Washington's hopelessly narrow vision of what's possible, simply because those ideas were the best ones they had found to the problems in front of them. They've never been afraid to demand the impossible. And I think we're living in times where we need a little bit more of that. For me, Bob McChesney and John Nichols taught me that the media system we have, it isn't magical, it isn't natural. It's the result of political decisions and policy decisions and business decisions. And just because the public has been historically left out of those decisions doesn't mean that things have to stay that way. That's why we started Free Press. And we're excited because we're about to celebrate our 10th anniversary. Two other people here need to share in that anniversary. One of them is Josh Silver. Josh had the audacity to take Bob and John's ideas and their analysis and actually put it into action, to start and lead this organization for 8 years. And I know I wouldn't be standing here without his energy or his vision. And the other person I want to be sure to thank is Kimberly Longy. We call her our organizational architect, because she's the one who took the energy of Josh and the ideas of Bob and John and actually built it into an institution. And she's still there doing that essential work 10 years later. And I know I wouldn't be here. I think I'd probably be in jail with Josh somewhere for violating some regulations if it wasn't for Kimberly. But anybody who's committed to social change works knows that the truly important things often happen behind the scenes or below the surface. And that's certainly the work that Kimberly has done. Now, when we started Free Press a decade ago, we believed that when people understood that they had the fundamental right to change the broken and corrupted media system, that millions of them would actually try to do that. And we were right. But if you had asked us back then, if you'd asked us to predict what the next decade would look like, so much of what we actually accomplished would have been unthinkable. I mean, we started with Bob McChesney's personal mailing list, and we built an army of 650,000 activists. We went from a few people huddled up the street here in a tiny apartment in Northampton to a team of 36 dedicated organizers and creative campaigners, sharp legal minds, and influential advocates. And we seized these once obscure issues like media consolidation and net neutrality and made them national concerns, talked about by the press and the president and around kitchen tables too. We took an issue with our friends at Prometheus Radio Project in Petri Dish, low-power FM radio, thanks to the amazing work of that group, created hundreds of low-power FM stations, including Valley Free Radio here. And we're about to see hundreds or maybe thousands more created this October when a window opens up for new community radio license. That's the work of our allies like Prometheus, and that's the work of Free Press. Over the last 10 years, we've tried to challenge some of the most powerful institutions and biggest companies in Washington, and I think we've won a lot more than anybody expected. So in our anniversary year, we plan to celebrate those victories. But the honest truth is that it's not enough. Because 10 years later, in most ways, for most people, the media aren't really better. It's not enough. Policymaking is still dominated by giant companies and influence peddlers. Journalism is in crisis. Public and community media are starved for support. It's not enough. The free and open internet is under attack. The surveillance state surpasses our worst nightmares. It's simply not enough. So this is not the time for us to tinker around the edges. It's not the time to get lost in the weeds. It's not the time to settle in Washington for the compromises on capitulations that we're told are the best we can get right now. I think the better choice and the only choice is to go bigger, to get louder, and to broaden Washington's hopelessly narrow view of what's possible. And in the end, that means that media reform, what this organization was founded to do, media reform is no longer enough. We have a more fundamental battle in front of us, and I would call that fighting for our rights to connect and communicate. And I know from traveling around with Bob and John these past few weeks that people everywhere are fed up with the media. They're tired of being lied to and ripped off. They want to control their online experiences, and they want their leaders in Washington not to spy on them, but to actually listen to them. That's why we started Free Press. We started Free Press to give people a way to fight back, to translate this popular outrage into lasting policy change. And so we're kicking off over the next few weeks our second decade with an unprecedented campaign to engage the public in creative new ways, to forge alliances with other groups fighting the money, media, and election complex, and to build new champions in Washington by mobilizing millions more people than ever before. And one of the important things we do need to do is we need to break down these silos. We need to break down the silos between what's been called media reform, campaign finance reform, election reform, because we're all in the same fight. We're all fighting against this media, money, and election complex that Bob and John do such a good job of describing, and they're working together, the media and the money and the politicians. So why aren't we? If you want a democracy and not a dollarocracy, you've come to the right place tonight. And if you want a democracy and not a dollarocracy, I really can't recommend this book enough, which will be available after the show. And if you want a democracy and not a dollarocracy, at Free Press, we need your help, because we're a people-powered organization. And if you haven't signed up to be a member, I hope you'll take out your smartphone or your pencils, Luddites, and write down or go to freepress.net. Consider becoming a supporter. We don't take any money from companies, political parties, or the government. We rely on you. And I promise that any money you give will be put immediately to work for your rights to connect and communicate. And if you sign up, we'll tell you about all the important things that are happening. And there's going to be a lot happening in this 10th anniversary year here in Northampton and across the country. You can take action on one of our campaigns to save the open and uncensored internet, to defend press freedom, to bring much-needed transparency to the political attack ads flooding our airwaves. And you can get involved. For example, we're organizing a huge rally on October 26th in Washington, D.C. against unchecked NSA spying. That's the anniversary of the Patriot Act. More than 3,000 people have already signed up to come to this rally. And it's going to be uniting a broad swath of groups from across the political spectrum. My Tea Party friends in the back will be more than welcome. And look, let's credit the Tea Party for speaking out first and often loudest against so much of what's been happening with this surveillance state. We're working to make it the biggest protest to date against NSA spying. And there's going to be a contingent going from here in Western Massachusetts, and I hope you'll join them. All of the info for that is available, once again, at freepress.net. So that's the end of my plugs. So now we're going to move on to the main event. Who's ready to be gobsmacked? All right. Well, please join me in welcoming the pride of Madison, Wisconsin, a great friend and mentor, Bob McChesney.
Well, thank you, Craig. I didn't mean to cut short your introduction. You were really on a roll there. That's great. Thank you for giving my speech. Thank you all for coming. Northampton's a lovely place. This is sort of a, I wouldn't say a second home, more like a fourth home. But since Josh and Kimberly and Craig and all the Free Press people here helped start Free Press, they got it started along with John and me, but they did the heavy lifting here in the Valley. Starting 10 years ago, really 11 years ago, when it really got going. I've come back here several times, and I've come to learn what Suck Jolly told me, my friend who teaches at the University of Massachusetts. Suck said, there's only one place I could live in the United States, Northampton. If I couldn't live there, I'd leave. And I thought, you know, that's a pretty strong endorsement of a city. If it's the only place you'd live in an entire country is in one city. That should be the slogan for Northampton. There's something, if I can't live in Northampton, I'm leaving the country. So I want to thank Free Press, who organized this, did all the work. I think the role of the organization, I hope you're supporting it. If you aren't, please absolutely do. And if you can, get a chance to go to that demonstration that Craig referred to against surveillance. I urge you to do so. I can't emphasize the importance of this issue enough. And, you know, I come from the late 60s, early 70s generation. We used to have lots of demonstrations then. They were really cool. But I was also there during the period in which people burnt out and got tired of going to demonstrations because you sort of thought they didn't work. And you go to the demonstrations because you sort of felt it was like your Lutheran duty to go to a demonstration to show you cared. Then you go to a bar and you have fun with your friends. And after a couple of times, you said, well, let's just skip the demonstration and go directly to the bar. And so people stopped doing it because it didn't seem like it had any effect. It was just spinning your wheels. It was just wasting your time. And one of the great developments, I think, that's taken place in the past 3 or 4 years has been that we've seen a number of spontaneous demonstrations erupt across this country dealing with the corruption of our governing process, the extraordinary inequality that has risen in our society. And it's been just exactly what demonstrations should be. It's something that has brought people together to see that you share common interests with so many other people, people oftentimes who aren't exactly like you, they're different from you. I was in Madison when the town exploded and thousands of people occupied the state capitol. I was a backbencher, I wasn't a leader, but I was there virtually every day with 5,000-10,000 people around the capitol, and on weekends 100,000 people. And when I was there, one thing struck me that was of singular importance because the feeling you got, the camaraderie, and to be blunt, the love you got from the karma of the people in these demonstrations was simply, until you experience, you can't describe it. There really aren't words for it. And it gave me energy, put fuel in my tank. And it taught me a very important lesson. It taught me why the right to assemble is one of the 5 core freedoms protected in the First Amendment. It's right up there. It's as important as any other freedom in the First Amendment, any other freedom in a free society. Because when people can get together physically, peacefully, and see each other and talk and express their desires, it gives a strength to people that it's much greater than the sum of the parts. It's exponentially larger. And the feeling you get from it is simply extraordinary. In some respects, it's like you've never lived until you've been in that moment. You come alive at that moment, and it energizes you. And that's why people in power are freaked out by demonstrations, especially peaceful ones. They hate them. They always have, and that's why it's in the Constitution. I'll tell you right now, the people in Washington, D.C. would rather have 20 million people tweeting each other the day of that demonstration than 150,000 people occupying the streets around the Capitol or the White House. They'll take 30 million tweets over 150,000 people physically occupying those streets. It's an extraordinary phenomenon. Demonstrations really do work. They really do have value. After the Occupy demonstrations, Barack Obama's talking about inequality suddenly in Occupy in his next speech. Better than that, in the Republican reply to the State of the Union address, Governor Bobby Jindal of Louisiana is talking about inequality and how we have to do something about it. Demonstrations get attention. They are great. If you can go, go. You will not be sorry. And get used to doing a lot more of that, because we're going to have to roll up our sleeves. We're going to get out of this mess. It's not just going to be candidates. It's not just going to be a referendum, it's not just going to be initiatives, it's also going to be the hard work of getting out and demonstrating, protesting, let people see what you're up to, getting people's attention, raising hell. Sometimes it's going to be civil disobedience. We're going to have to reach into the toolkit and take everything it takes to change this country's course, because we are no longer living in a democracy, and that's what our book's about. We are now living in what we call a dollarocracy. And by dollarocracy, well, I think sort of the name hopefully gives it away, what we're talking about. Democracy comes from the Greek, the rule of the people, the demos. Dollarocracy comes from the idea of the rule of money. Those with the most dollars have the most votes. Those without any dollars have no votes. It's $1, one vote, not one person, one vote. This is something that most people already know. And the research on this is quite striking. Several major studies have come out in the last 3 years by leading political scientists, and they all basically reach the same conclusion. On virtually every issue of importance that the government deals with, the attitudes, opinions, concerns of the great bulk of the population, the bottom 90, 95, dare I say it, 99%, have absolutely no influence on the government whatsoever. None. This is shown over and over in the research on budget, taxation, regulation, trade, issue after issue of importance. The only people that matter are people with lots of money. They determine the policies we have. This is what our people have found, our scholars. Actual regular people really have almost no influence, even over their own elected representatives on these issues. Jimmy Carter, just last summer, said that the United States is no longer a functional democracy. In effect, we're off the democratic grid now. We're a dollarocracy. We're basically spectators, and they give this illusion where we can pretend we have some power, but we don't. And, people get it, too. The surveys show this. One of my favorite surveys, and we have it in the book, and I forget the exact percentage, but a significant percentage of Americans, when asked, say that they think we would be better off as a country if instead of electing members of Congress, we drew names out of a hat and just went to the phone book, said we can't do worse than what we've got now with all the people who are bought off. Let's just do jury style for members of Congress and save the $10 billion. I mean, it's funny, but it's absurd. But it shows just how much our democracy has degenerated, what a thin reed it is if we have one at all, and how really we are a dollarocracy. Now, this is not some sort of esoteric matter. This is an abstract concern. This is a real concern that greatly affects the quality of all our lives. It leads to, it immediately and instantly, all sorts of corruption. I mean, that's the whole hallmark of dollarocracy, people buying power, getting their way. It also leads to, it increases inequality. And it's not a surprise that inequality in the United States today is the worst it has been in many, many, many generations. And it continues to grow year after year after year. It's the source of increased poverty, because those are the dollars that run our government really don't give a damn about those at the bottom. That's the whole point. So we have more poverty today than we have had in generations. 47% of the American population now is either in poverty or is considered low income. And low income by U.S. government standards, if you were in Europe, that would be called poverty rates, that lifestyle. This is poor. We haven't been a country like that for a long time. In terms of inequality now, there's a thing sociologists and economists use called the Gini Index, which measures inequality in a society, how many rich people, how poor they are, and the gap between them all across the society. And what we found is the United States today has a Gini Index measuring economic inequality closer to the Philippines or Malaysia than it does to Western Europe or Japan. We're closer to a third world country in terms of inequality, a developing economy, than we are to our peer nations in Europe and East Asia. We're getting off the democratic grid, but we're right in the heart of dollarocracy. And what we see most tragically, but also most hopefully in some respects, is that young people today face a world that's much grimmer than the one I faced when I came of age. When I left college, and I was unemployed in 1977, I got a job in a lumberyard. And it was a union job. They actually had those things then. You've probably heard of them, unions. You know, you get better salaries, yeah. It was a union job, so I'd be like $10.25 an hour. And I was able to walk in and get this. I was the only person with a college degree at the place working there. And I went back and I tried to figure out, as my unemployed daughter was working for minimum wage jobs when she got out of college, I tried to figure out what my $10.25 in 1977 would translate into in 2013. And I think it was something like $39 an hour. So I was saying, boy, what if my daughter could make $78,000 a year, which is basically what I was making at that union job, what would she think of that? And she probably would, you know, chop off her foot for a job like that, or my foot at least. That's just how different the world is, how different the futures look from these generations. And it's only going to get worse. We're in stagnation that's endless, and it's a stagnation that owes largely to dollarocracy. The people in power are perfectly content with this type of political economy. This is the great defining crisis of our time, and how we address it will really talk about everything we do going forward. And the solution to the crisis is clear. The solution to dollarocracy is democracy. The solution is to get people real power, real control over their lives, real political democracy, and then we'll start having real solutions to these great problems, and not bogus solutions or non-solutions, which is currently all we get, plateful after plateful. In this book, what John and I do is we look at the election system specifically and how the election system has been corrupted and compromised to the point where elections have lost their traditional role. Now, the elections are very important, and I obsess over them, I confess. John and I probably, if we had a nickel for every time we talked about elections, electoral politics in the last 20 years, we could fund Free Press and Josh's group. We'd have so much money, we'd be rolling in it. But unfortunately, we don't have a nickel or a dollar for every time. But they're important for one crucial reason. In an electoral democracy, elections are the one time when Bill Gates, the Walmart heirs, and hedge fund billionaires have the exact same amount of power as the woman who cleans the toilets at Walmart from midnight to 7 a.m. They each have one vote. And that's what makes democracy and elections beautiful. Everyone's got one vote. And that's pretty good, if you think about it. That sounds good. I like that. I think most people say, hey, that's a right-on idea. There are some people, though, who don't think that's such a great idea. The Walmart heirs, for example. They don't like the idea that all those people have votes, and there's a lot more of them than there are heirs to billion-dollar fortunes. And that creates a problem. And that's a great tension in America today, and it's always been a tension in American democracy. It's always been a battle about who can vote and who can't. You know, when this country was founded in the 1780s, you know, it was less than 10% of adults were able to vote and participate, less than 10%. Over 90% did not have a right to participate. And Benjamin Franklin, who was one of the most progressive of our founders, put it well. He said, those who are not allowed to vote are enslaved to those who can. It was a form of slavery, in effect, in a political society not to be allowed to vote. And the great struggles in American history from that day, from the 1780s until the 20th century, were expanding the franchise to let women vote, to let Native Americans vote, to let African Americans vote, ultimately to let 18 to 20-year-olds vote, those who fought so many of our wars but were never allowed to participate in the electoral process. And we didn't become a fully developed electoral democracy until the early 1970s, when 100% of Americans over 18 had a right to vote. And even then, there are all sorts of problems with not letting prisoners vote or ex-prisoners vote that continue. So you really couldn't even call us a fully, but then the prison war hadn't gotten so bad at that point, the prison crisis. But at any rate, we got as good as it got by the early 1970s. Now, in our talks, I'm often held up as sort of the Prince of Darkness, the guy who's always talking about how gloomy it is. You getting that vibe so far yet? Well, it's getting worse. Just want to prepare you. Just want to lube you up there and know what's coming. But you know, the good news is this. We've actually won a lot of victories in the last century. If you go look at the period from, say, 1900 to 1970, it's not just a constant story of the big guys, the fat cats, big shots winning everything. Hardly. They won a lot, but they lost a lot. The people of this country won a lot, too. You know, we won the right to have trade unions. We won the right to have women to vote. We won Social Security. We won Medicare and Medicaid. We won the Voting Rights Act. We've won a lot of great victories in that period. We managed to have the GI Bill and to expand higher education to broad reaches of our population, far more than any other country in the world a generation before anyone else. We managed to have public schools become a credible institution for poor people for a while in this country. Those were great victories. Those were won by organizing. Those were democratic victories. They made this country a much better place to live in. And they made the country a much nicer place, and they were due to organized political work. And in fact, by 1970 or so, this country was changing quite a bit. And if you looked at the country in 1970, it was a very different place than it is today, or than it had been before that. It was a country in which business was probably held at its lowest ebb at any time in American history. Big business, and poll after poll, was seen as being a really disreputable, monopolistic, corrupt, sleazy affair. It was held in low regard. Ralph Nader, in polling, was considered the most respectable, most impressive American across the political spectrum. People thought he was the best American. Ralph Nader was someone who inspired young people to think that they could organize together and they could affect social change. They could make the government be a source for good. It could actually do something positive in people's lives, that it would have that possibility. And to those in business, this was not a pleasant situation. And in 1971, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce was deeply concerned about what it thought, business losing its grasp and control over American society. And they commissioned a memo from a gentleman named Lewis Powell, who at that time was one of the leading corporate attorneys in the country, who made a fortune as a multimillionaire representing the tobacco industry. And Powell wrote a short and sweet memo. It's available online. Just Google Lewis Powell memo, and you'll find it. And you can read it in about 10 minutes. But it really is one of those documents that ought to be assigned in school, along with like the Emancipation Proclamation, the Declaration of Independence. It's a central document that explains American politics, for better or for worse. Because in it, Powell lays out a brilliant master plan saying, the problem we have in America today is we have too much democracy. That's the crisis of democracy. The problem we have is all sorts of people who are traditionally apathetic, women, blacks, young people. They're getting too interested in politics. They're making demands on the system. We've got to get them to go back to their couches and let the traditional rulers resume control of the ship of state. That's the crisis we face in America today. And Powell said, what we have to do is have a huge increase in corporate spending on politics. That's what the mission critical is. We've got to have corporations understand they've got to devote massive resources to go to Washington and take over the government. That's what we have to do. And this memo was shared with leading CEOs of all the largest companies, leading billionaires, and their friends in the country. He called for forming things like foundations that would do ideological work to extol the virtues of business and profits, free enterprise, and entrepreneurs, and denigrate labor unions, social programs like Social Security, public education, and sort of put them down, raise them up to elevate the political power and ideological power of big business in our society. And it was largely implemented very quickly. Within really less than two decades, there was a tenfold increase of corporate lobbyists in Washington, D.C. K Street, which didn't exist as a term, became a catchphrase like Wall Street or Madison Avenue as the center of lobbying as a result of that. And it had tremendous effect. They managed to make both political parties, not just the Republicans, but both political parties, far more attentive to the needs of big business. Because their goal was simple, as Powell put it. Whoever wins the election, we win. That's the goal. We want to create a system, no matter who wins the election, nothing changes for us. We are still in the driver's seat. That was the goal. Now, one of the things that Powell also called for, and what's interesting about this, he said, the Supreme Court and these federal courts are getting way out of hand. You know, we've got presidents, even Republican presidents, pro-business presidents, appointing people to the Supreme Court, and they have these lifetime appointments, and then they go rogue on us, like Earl Warren or Warren Blackmun, and they start, you know, they look at the Constitution and they sort of talk about civil rights and civil liberties and things like that, and they don't understand the importance of business. So we've got to create a group like what would become the Federalist Society so that we will always have judges that understand the needs of business have to come first. And he said, we really got to get judges like that on the court. Well, here's a coincidence for you. Guess what happened 2 months after his memo was distributed confidentially to all CEOs? There was an opening on the U.S. Supreme Court. And guess who Richard Nixon appointed? Lewis Powell. And he joined the Supreme Court after winning the vote 99-1. In his confirmation hearings, that memo wasn't talked about. It wasn't publicized. That was a private memo. And the great cause that Lewis Powell assumed upon taking the Supreme Court was the cause of having unlimited spending by businesses and individuals on political campaigns. He said, that's the greatest First Amendment issue of our times, letting businesses and campaigns spend as much as possible. And for the next 40 years or 35 years after he got to the court and voted on that, made a decision on, to that effect, people in law schools have been trying to be very generous. Yeah, Lewis Powell really cares about democracy and elections. He's really trying to figure out a way to make them work so people can contribute. And then you read the Powell memo, no, that's BS. Lewis Powell wants to make sure democracy doesn't work. He wants to stack the deck so his side can't lose. That's why he was obsessed with this issue. Once you read the Powell memo, it all comes sharply into focus, clearly into focus. Now, he didn't get his way on the Supreme Court. He was opposed, believe it or not, by William Rehnquist, who was an old school conservative who didn't think corporations were people and didn't think the Supreme Court should be necessarily in the job of regulating elections, something it hadn't really done. Before then. But once Rehnquist was gone, onto the court came John Roberts, who was the Federalist Society's poster child. He was someone like Lewis Powell, was just dedicated to making maximum money into politics, dedicating basically to rigging the system as much as possible, hence the most recent decision this last summer, where he overturned the crucial part of the Voting Rights Act, so now states can reinstitute voter suppression measures that were illegal. For the last 50 years, measures that were commonly used during the Jim Crow era to prevent African Americans from voting in the South, and now are used to prevent blacks, poor people, and young people from voting, or making it so difficult to vote, the cost will be so high they'll just blow it off. He's a champion of that, and in 2010, he was the champion of Citizens United, the case which basically made it possible for there to be unlimited money to flood into campaigns, and largely unaccountable money, money that can't be traced. And that's where we stand today. Now, a lot of people say, well, Citizens United, don't exaggerate its importance. And I think it's right not to exaggerate it. Larry Lessig put it best. He said, the Citizens United decision fired a bullet into the body of democracy, but the body was already cold. The body was already cold. It was already in serious problem. But it has had its effect nonetheless. It has allowed this third party unaccountable money to flood in. We don't know who's giving it oftentimes. We don't even know exactly how it's all being spent. And it's really changing the nature of the game of politics. We aren't even sure how it's going to completely change it. The one thing we do know it's changing, though, is it's increased the amount being spent. It's increasing the amount being spent. In 2012, by our calculations, $10 billion was spent on American elections, double what was spent in 2008, 10 times what was spent a generation ago, even allowing for inflation. That's a lot of money, folks. That is a whole lot of money. How does the USA compare to other countries? Just to put this in context, last week after we got back from the Washington trip with Free Press, I went on and I did some calculations roughly to figure out, you know, how does our spending and our national elections, just federal elections, congressional and president, compared to other democracies in the world. This is what I found. Canada, which is a pretty similar country to us, just north of here, in 2011 had their most recent national elections. For every dollar Canadian politicians and campaigns spent on their national elections, America campaigns spent eight times as much. So we spent not 8%, 800%, eight times as much as Canada. Norway just had their recent national elections a month ago in Norway. And for every dollar Norwegians spent that were spent in Norway on their political campaigns in their national elections, we spent 10 times more in 2012. We topped them by 10 times. So for every dollar, we spent 10. Oh, by the way, Norway's ranked the number one democracy in the world. These guys had to get with the program. You got to spend more money to improve it. Imagine if they spent our sort of money, they could be number one with a bullet. And then how about the United Kingdom? They had their last national elections in 2010. And for every dollar spent by politicians and parties in 2010 in the UK on their national elections, the USA in 2012 spent 29 times as much, $29 for every UK dollar. And then Germany just had their national elections last week. And in Germany, for every dollar the parties and were spent entirely on that campaign, their national elections, US in 2012 spent $32. 32-to-1 ratio, US to Germany. Now here's an aside for you. In all four of those elections, those national elections where the money spent was so much lower, the conservatives won all those elections. You know, in other countries, conservatives think they can actually win an election without buying it. They can actually win a fair fight. In this country, they say, not in this country, we can't win a fair fight. But that's an aside. Now here's a question to ask yourself about that. If we spend 32 times as much in Germany on, say, early childhood education, let's say whatever Germany spends per student in elementary school, the United States spent 32 times as much on every American child, what sort of education would we be able to give American kids? It'd be unbelievable. It'd be mind-blowing. You'd have class sizes of like 5 students. Each kid would have a tutor, a masseuse, a personal trainer. I mean, every kid would get an education Bill Gates' kids would dream about getting. They would be an amazing country. It'd be the greatest democracy ever if we outspent Germany 32-to-1 in early childhood education. It'd blow our minds. But when you outspend a country 32-to-1 in campaign spending, it doesn't have that effect. It's the exact opposite. The more money you spend, the more bogus it is. So we have 53% turnout in 2012. Germany had the lowest turnout in a long time, 72%. They're whining about it. We haven't seen 72% since the 19th century in this country. 72% would have people doing backflips down Madison Avenue. We even got over 60% right now, people would be jumping off buildings with parachutes and hang gliding in glee. Our elections are a farce compared to all these other countries. And we spend so much more, but the money doesn't help us at all. It's the exact opposite. And there's a couple crucial reasons for this. First of all, I give money to campaigns. I suspect many of you do in here. Generally, it's $50, $100 to a candidate. I'm trying to advance a civic cause, someone I believe in, someone's good. I'm not doing it because I think I will get a tax break, or I would get a contract, or anything like that. And when you're in Citizens United here, the people who take advantage of that, they're in a whole different league from us. They're not giving $50 or $100 like because they really believe in the values of a candidate. They're trying to invest. They're trying to go from point A to point B. They're trying to make money off it. It's a commercial investment for these people. Now, most of the people who are spending this vast amount of money, we don't know much about them. They want to be secret. They want to be unknown. But there are a couple of hot dogs out there who like the limelight, who we can learn from. And probably hot dog number one is a guy from Las Vegas, Nevada, named Shelley Adelson. Some of you probably heard of this guy. Spent $150 million on a variety of candidates last year. Lost most of the races he bankrolled, but not all of them. And Shelley Adelson had a candid interview after the election where he said, look, and I'm paraphrasing, he said, look, I'm in favor of socialized medicine. I believe in a woman's right to choose. I'm fine with gay marriage, same-sex marriage. I think climate change is a real problem. I think these are all real issues. But when I donate to a candidate, I have 3 issues I'm concerned about. I hate labor unions. I don't want them in my business or anywhere around. I don't want to pay taxes. And I'm doing some pretty fishy stuff over in Asia. I really don't want the government to investigate it too closely. I don't want to go to jail. I'd rather be a billionaire. And that's why I invest in candidates, because I want results on those 3 fronts. I'm worth $30 billion. I want to be worth $60 billion. I'm ad-libbing now. I don't want to be worth $10 billion or in jail. That's why he invests in politics. If he invested because of his values, what he believed in, socialized medicine, you know, he'd be a socialist. The Green Party would have $150 million. But he doesn't invest in those. He doesn't care about that stuff. It's a cash investment. And that's why these guys invest in politics. It's a cash investment. And the other point on this issue for why this is so different and the money is so bad is you look at where does the money go? And where the money goes, above and all, is to TV political advertising. This is really the lingua franca of our politics. And it's the lingua franca not just because the amount of it has skyrocketed, $6 billion of the $10 billion was spent on TV political ads, but because there's absolutely no journalism that we can have to cover politics anymore. So we're really reduced to watching these TV ads to get information on candidates. And I think in fairness, to cut the talk a little shorter, we can just all agree these ads are completely asinine. They really are an insult to the intelligence of all human beings. By the way, those four countries that don't spend any money in ads, they don't do TV political ads in Norway or Germany or Britain. They're illegal there. They're considered toxic propaganda. They say you gotta actually do politics. You can't just buy a bunch of Madison Avenue ads. And what is the problem with these ads? What is the danger with them? Well, Thomas Paine, in his classic book, Common Sense, the first sentence in it is worth reading. In it, it says, "A long habit of not thinking something wrong gives it the superficial appearance of being right." A long habit of not thinking something wrong gives it the superficial appearance of being right. And that's what our political culture is like. We're immersed in these ads, and people grow up thinking, well, this is how you do politics in a free society. When in fact, this is completely contrary to how we did politics prior to 1960. It's completely contrary to how real democracies, other democracies that are more successful, where people actually vote and have choices, do politics in other countries for a lot less money. And as we looked at our history and looked at the way advertising is done in this country, what we were struck by and what really jumped out at us was when TV political advertising first emerged in the 1960s, it was despised by most Americans. Immediately, it was hated. And they do surveys, an ad agency did a survey on what people thought of political advertising, and they stopped even, you know, the choices were, I really totally hate it, I sort of totally hate it, I sort of don't like it very much, I'm not sure how much I hate it. They didn't even have, like, I like it as an option, because no one ever answered, so they just took it off the ballot. People always hated it. The other thing we discovered, and this is the most striking thing about it, is that the amount of advertising that is positive has diminished. Almost all those ads in the 60s and 70s were positive ads. They were like Jimmy Carter picking up the soil and saying, look at me, I'm a farmer. You know, it's a stupid ad, but it's a stupid ad. It's about Jimmy Carter. Starting then, though, we saw, by the 90s, we saw 10, 20, 30% of the ads attack ads, 40%. By 2000, over 50 or 60%. In the last election, really in the 80 to 90% range, all were negative attack ads. In some races, 100%. Basically, negative attack ads are American political discourse today. That's where we get our politics. And, you know, this is one of the reasons why some of the strongest critics of our political system are on Madison Avenue. People who do advertising for commercial customers, they hate it. And the reason they hate political advertising is that they think it makes what they do disreputable. They get tarnished by being associated with it. For example, they'll be the first one to tell you, you don't see negative advertising in commercial products. If Coca-Cola ran ads saying, Pepsi is terrible, because in late at night when no one's looking, the workers at the Pepsi factory pee in the vat. So don't drink Pepsi, whatever you do. Well, it wouldn't help Coke, because Coke only benefits if people buy Coke, not if people don't buy Pepsi. Likewise, Pepsi would just respond by saying, hey, over there, they vomit in the vats. So people don't buy. So then what happens? No one buys any cola drink. Both of them go down. And so no one would ever think of doing that. It's mutually assured destruction. So they don't do negative ads in commercial campaigns. In politics, though, negative ads make a lot of sense, and they work. And they work for a couple of crucial reasons. First of all, elections are very different than markets. Pepsi could get 49.9% of the market for cola drinks and be one of the most profitable companies in the world, make spectacular profits. But a candidate in a two-party system who gets 49.9% of the votes, out of luck. You lose everything. You're broke. You're out of business. You no longer exist. So going from 49.9 to 50.1 is everything. And whatever it takes to get over that ledge from 49.1 to 50.1 is worth it, whatever it takes. And frankly, negative ads work. These guys aren't dummies. You stop doing them and your opponent does them, your numbers go down. You start doing them, your opponent doesn't, your numbers go up. They actually do work. Now, they can't take someone in a third party who's obscure and make them win an election, but they, in a close race, they can absolutely be decisive, and they tend to be. This is the secret work. And focus groups show this. Focus groups, they take voters, they'll talk to them before the election, and all the voters go, oh, I hate those negative ads. I'd never vote for a candidate as one of those negative ads. They're terrible. Oh, I hate them. And everyone agrees, says, yeah, me too. And everyone agrees and pats themselves in the back, says, I wonder what moron believes those things. And then they leave, and then they bring them back to reconvene the focus group after the election. And they say, oh, who'd you vote for? And they'll ask people who they voted for and who they didn't vote for. And what they find is people, when they explain who they don't vote for, almost verbatim use the content of negative ads. Yeah, well, she's soft on terrorism. Yeah, where'd you get that? but the ads work. They found that out. The ads actually do work. And so they do them, and they will continue to do them. Well, I think I could go on and on. The moral of the story here, and what's essential here, is that this is a system that needs to change. This is not acceptable. As we go to the internet and we chronicle this in the book, we're finding the internet, rather than solving the problem, is actually making it worse. We're seeing that the internet's being converted, as we now know from the NSA scandal, from something where we're all anonymous and we can go wherever we want and we can find information and we have the control, to a place where they know everywhere you go, they know everything about you, and they can tailor messages just to you, knowing what buttons to push. And you're the only person who will get the message or will see what they want you to see. And I'm talking about political candidates. The Obama campaign perfected this in 2012. They were the head of it. And a lot of people said, well, I like the Obama campaign, so I don't mind this. Well, wait till Shelley Adelson gets his checkbook out and starts doing specialized digital advertising that knows everything about you and tells just the message to say to you. You might not think it's such a great thing. It's really no solution for where we're going. Now, one thing that also is a key part of our book is the decline and elimination of journalism. And if we had great media, great journalism, the billionaires would have a much harder time trying to buy our elections because people would have alternative places to get information, alternative sources. So this is a media story as much as anything, and we shouldn't forget that. Another thing I want to conclude with is that people oftentimes, when they hear me talk, I don't know why, they get depressed. They say, oh, it's hopeless now. You've talked to me, I was planning to get married and have children and buy a house. Now, I'm gonna buy a lot of drugs and just see what happens. But I'm actually, and this is really true, people who know me and John, I'm like the most optimistic person in America. I don't get it. I think the truth will set you free. I wanna know what's actually the truth about how it is so I can change it. And I'm optimistic, and I'm optimistic for a very simple reason. Because I think this is a progressive country. The great crisis of our society today is this dollarocracy political system is over here controlled by money. It is completely discussing issues and policies that are irrelevant to the great bulk of Americans. At the same time, most Americans, from my experience, are fairly progressive, certainly relative to 30 years ago. There's an openness to new ideas, especially among young people, that hasn't been there in a long time. And there's an opportunity here. And one of the things that gives me warmth and courage and strength as I go forward is they get that. The dollarocrats get that. That's why they're obsessed with being able to buy elections. That's why they're obsessed with suppressing the vote. They know they can't win a fair fight. If they could win a fair fight, they wouldn't have to do that. They're obsessed with it. That should give us strength. We've got the numbers on our side. That means all we've got to do is get out, raise hell, and organize, and we'll win. On that note, let me introduce you to the only person in the world more optimistic than me, John Nichols.
Sorry to be late to the podium here. I was upstairs watching you from behind your heads. And it's very cool to watch from up there. State Senator Jamie Eldridge is here tonight, sitting over there. And he represents, over by Concord, Massachusetts. And I said, we were talking about maybe doing an event there sometime. I said, oh, that'd be cool to come to Concord, because I could maybe speak at the Lyceum there. And he said, maybe, it could happen. They have down nights and off evenings. And I said, well, that'd be really cool. I could speak in the same place where Emerson spoke. And then I'm standing out in the lobby trying to avoid McChesney's speech, and I'm reading the sign, and I realize this is where Emerson spoke, right here. So I don't have to go to Concord. Sorry, Jamie. I'm so glad to be here in Northampton, Massachusetts, where everybody cool who's ever been anywhere comes to. Thank you very much for having us here. And you know what I love the most about this part of Massachusetts? Shays Rebellion. I swear, we're driving out to this wonderful event out at Lisa Baskin's house. And, you know, of course, I don't know anything about anything, so they say, oh, yeah, you're coming to Northampton, we'll have an event at Lisa Baskin's house. That's cool, sounds great. And then I think it's like, you know, north side of Northampton. No, it's like in, like, another state. And so we're driving, we're late, we're on country roads and sort of lost, and, you know, it's getting, like, kind of that, like, one of those bad movies sort of thing, you know, a couple of authors get lost on a country road. You know, and like it's like Kathy Ireland, whoever that woman is with the hammer on your knee, and it's just very scary. And then I swear I'm not making this up. We're driving down the road, and it's like, where are we going? And then right in front of us is a car with a license plate that says Shays Rebellion 2. And I said to McChesney, he's driving. I said, throw away the GPS. We follow the Shays Rebellion car, right? And I'm not making it up, car wheels right up the driveway. We are at our destination. And the reason that Shays Rebellion is consequential to our remarks this evening is, of course, because Shays Rebellion was the first great post-revolutionary American revolt against concentrated economic power and the abuses that concentrated economic power rests upon the shoulders of the great mass of Americans. The people who participated in Shays' rebellions were the veterans of the Revolution. They missed any kind of boom times back in Northampton or, you know, Great Barrington or these other communities, wherever Josh Silver lives. And they missed the good times because they were out fighting the British. And they come home and they find out that all the business people, all the corporate types, had made quite a bit of money by borrowing money and you know, kind of moving. Look, let's be clear. War profiteering, never a bad industry, ever. And so they had piled up, you know, they'd kind of advanced themselves. And they didn't want to pay the debts that they had made. And so their plan was to tax the Revolutionary War soldiers who'd come back and make them pay for the debts that the people who didn't go and fight the war ran up doing war profiteering. And the Shays Rebellion folks, you know, like, Daniel Shays is like, I think that is bogus, right? You know, because, like, wars are hard, and you know, we had to, like, cross the Delaware and stuff, and you know, they didn't even let us read Tom Paine, it had to be read to us, and you know, and so we don't go for that. And so they, like, rebelled. And they rebelled in the winter and spring of 1787. I'm thinking to yourself, what else happened in 1787? Well, I don't know. Oh, right. A constitution was written in this country. And they all gathered. They were gathered to write that constitution in Philadelphia. And I don't want to suggest that your history classes might not have taught history and, you know, kind of the perfect trajectory. But you understand that a bunch of quite wealthy people, business people, many of them elites, went down to Philadelphia to write a constitution in the summer of 1787, just after the military had to put down a rebellion by working class, poor farmers and shopkeepers against the wealthy taken from them, redistributing the wealth upwards. And they were not all that enthusiastic about democracy. No, seriously, you want to figure out where the Electoral College came from? Thank your buddy Daniel Shays, right? Because they're like, you know, if we let these people have too much control, there is a very, very good chance that they might actually want fairness. They might actually want a just society. They might actually seriously be reading Tom Paine, because Tom Paine didn't stop with common sense. He didn't stop with the crisis. Tom Paine kept right on writing. The last major book that Tom Paine wrote, Agrarian Justice, outlined a social welfare state. Tom Paine imagined Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid. Tom Paine said that anybody born in this country into poverty should be given a stipend when they turn 21, because it would be absolutely unfair to have a society where some could be born wealthy and some could be born poor, because the poor people would always be held down. And so there are a lot of people out there who took that stuff seriously. So a constitution was written in 1787 with a lot of very careful controls against people power. You should understand that. There are very good things. I love the Constitution. I'm a huge fan of it. Wonderful aspect of it that, no, I'm serious, wonderful, that, you know, George Mason, one of the essential authors, not just a basketball team, George Mason said, the point of this Constitution is to constrain rather than to facilitate war, to make it hard for people, for monarchs, kings, presidents to take us to war. That's a very good part of it. But the problem was that structurally, that Constitution was not written to empower people. That was written in many, many ways to make sure the people didn't get in the way of the powerful. And a fascinating thing happened when they took this document out to America. They said, you know, hey, we've just written you a Constitution, and your role is very, very simple. It has to be ratified by the states, so you don't even need to really read it. Just ratify and send it back on up here, and we'll start governing. Well, some people actually read it, and they're like, an electoral college? What's that? You know, I mean, why can't we just elect a president? They had a lot of other objections. Every debate that you hear today about democracy in America was had in 1787, 1788, 1789. But the biggest objection was there were few routes in for the people to challenge the powerful. And so the people didn't ratify the Constitution. States across the country, up and down the East Coast, they were like, we don't like this thing. We are not particularly excited by what you 37 gentlemen, white gentlemen, who decided that African Americans were 3/5 of human beings. We don't particularly like what you 37 white gentlemen who decided that women, nah, ixnay on their voting. And we don't particularly like that you folks are trying to set up a system where once we get going with elections, about 6% of Americans will actually be able to vote. There was a lot of objection. And you know what they demanded? A Bill of Rights. That was the deal that got states to actually sign on. James Madison, essential author of the Constitution, ran a congressional race in Virginia in 1791, against James Monroe. And Madison's campaign promise, now this is, I gotta tell you, I don't care what you think about Dennis Kucinich, or Jesse Jackson, or Ron Paul, you give me your candidate who's out there with a great big vision for where this country ought to go, you're not gonna beat James Madison in 1790. I'm gonna give you a Bill of Rights. That was his campaign promise. He got elected, came up to New York City, where they actually wrote the Bill of Rights. The first that Congress met on Wall Street, if you can believe it. It's the last useful thing to come off Wall Street. So they get there and they write this Bill of Rights. And the fascinating thing about the Bill of Rights, what does that First Amendment say? Right? The right to freedom of speech. I'm up here with my, I do a little speaking. Freedom of religion. Let's not mess with that. Let's not tell people one religion's good, another one's bad. The right to assemble. That's getting interesting, because now we're all here together, right? If I'm just speaking on my own, that's not much. But if we assemble, that's getting kind of interesting. And the right to petition for the redress of grievances. You know what that means? We can actually make demands on power. They may not let us vote, but we can assemble and make a demand. It's getting interesting here. And then they put something else in there that was kind of a big deal. Because they figured, if we are going to start to talk about empowering the great mass of people, remember the Bill of Rights was the demand of the people for more. If we start empowering them, we better give them a free press. We better absolutely ensure that they have a free press. Because as Jefferson so wisely said, and this was the brilliance of Jefferson, flawed man, and he was the first to admit his flaws. But Thomas Jefferson said, and by the way, also a guy who hated the newspapers of his day, just despised them, so he didn't read them, maybe on the side. But Thomas Jefferson said, there's an absolute guarantee, one absolute guarantee. You elect officials, you give them power, they will be corrupted. Guarantee they're gonna start to bow to economic power, they're gonna start to bow to those who call the shots, less to the people, more to the power. And presidents will be corrupted. It said, so you better recognize that power, the power to keep this country free, is going to be rested in the people. And you better inform the people. So how did they inform the people? How did that free press work? Because this is a big deal for everything we're talking about now. They did not say, I've checked the Constitution, I've actually read it, the Bill of Rights, twice, just this evening, just to check. There is no mention of Rupert Murdoch. Nothing. Limbaugh, I mean, I was quite certain Limbaugh was going to be in there somewhere. No mention of him either. The interesting thing is there's no mention of NBC, ABC, CBS. There's no mention of any major broadcasting conglomerate or billionaire, millionaire TV personality or radio person. None of that. It's not there. Because that's not what the founders intended. They didn't create a free press protection to create billions for Rupert Murdoch. That wasn't the point. They created a free press protection so that there would be a wild, cacophonous press that would inform all the people, that would give you ideas from every perspective, ideas as radical as Tom Paine on the left, as radical as John Adams on the right. I know you're Massachusetts, you're supposed to like him, but the guy, yeah, Alien and Sedition Acts, excuse me? And so, you know, they wanted to have this whole range of perspective out there. And there wasn't advertising in those days. They didn't have advertising. It wasn't like you didn't have Toyota ads in the American Aurora. There wasn't like, you know, Viagra ads with the two people sitting in the bathtubs there. You know, you didn't have any of that stuff. So how did you pay for a free press? Because also, you were yeoman farmers and shopkeepers who had very little money, and what they had was being taxed away from them to pay for the war debts of the rich guys. And so how did you pay for a free press? The government did it. The government did it. The government did it. Yeah. We created the most massive postal subsidies in the history of the world up to that point. We subsidized newspapers. We also, in this country, at the founding of the American experiment, subsidized all over this country different newspapers in different states, actually subsidies so that you would have competing views in different states. There was actually a debate in Congress about whether the government should supply, for, on any major issue, a sheet of paper for every American citizen on which each side of the debate would be printed and it would be sent out to the people. We had a massive, for the first 60 years of the American experiment, massive subsidies to create a free press in this country. Because there was a realization that if you did not have a free press, you could not possibly have anything akin to democracy. It was undoable because the people would not be informed. The wealthy, the powerful would be informed, but there'd be no information flowing to everybody else. Now, how big a deal was this? Do you know how big a deal it was with the subsidy? Remember, they subsidized with no ideology whatsoever. Not left, not right, not conservative, not liberal, not what became the Democratic Party, not what would ultimately evolve to the Republicans. None of that. This was a postal subsidy. You did a newspaper, it went through the mails. And the incredible thing about it was that the first African-American businesses to get a break from the United States government were abolitionist newspapers run by freed slaves. They'd come north, free in slavery. They started a little newspaper. They sent it through the mails. This was a huge issue. Postal subsidies was one of the central issues of the small D American democratic experiments at the start of the last century, or start of the 19th century. There were riots in the South because abolitionist newspapers came through the mail. And this was a very big deal because it's what moved this country forward. Alexis de Tocqueville came from France. He toured the United States. He said, this is the most incredible thing I've ever seen. newspapers everywhere, ordinary people putting their opinions out on all sides of these issues, this incredible, great, vibrant debate. Why, if other countries did this, freedom would spread around the world. Democracy would actually be on the march. It was an amazing thing that happened. Done without advertising, almost no advertising. Well, fast forward to the current moment, because we're back where we were at the founding. We don't have advertising anymore, right? There was a period of about 100 years where our press was funded by advertising. And it was, I mean, they got so many ads that they could throw a little journalism in with it. Right? Seriously, just a little. But the fact of the matter is, advertising has left the field. It's not there anymore. You can't get advertising to sustain a newspaper at a sufficient level today. Now, I know there's these women, wonderful women, are sitting there going, I don't know, I still get a newspaper. But is it as good as what you got 20 years ago? And I don't want you to be nostalgic about this. I'm telling you, what's happened is, across this country, they've culled out journalism in this country. Think about what's happened here. Since 2009, 22,000 newspaper employees have lost their jobs. 22,000 positions that existed have been lost. Now, in 2009, 64,000 people, as the estimate, were working as journalists in this country. Now, not everybody's lost a job as a journalist. Some were assistants and other aides in the newspapers. But just think about that. This huge culling out of tens of thousands of newspaper employees, the kind of core institution that covers our communities, gone. Radio. Well, you think, well, radio's got to be great. There's something wonderful about radio. Bill Newman is here. And so, you know, radio works for us. Except that since the Telecommunications Act of 1996, one of the most crony capitalist corrupt things you've ever seen, we've lost almost 20,000 radio personalities in the United States, local people who did news. Bill Newman is the last. He's it. Give him a round of applause, because that's it. It's over when Newman goes off the stage. But that's a horrible reality, right? It shouldn't be that way. There should be 20 Bill Newmans everywhere. And there ought to even be, you know, somebody who doesn't talk about drug busts on the radio. And so the bottom line, it's an inside joke. The bottom line is this. Radio, television, all these things have collapsed. And here's the interesting thing. The interesting thing about it all is that as this has happened, television has left the field. Television news, which most people get their information from, tells us almost nothing today. And if you don't believe me, watch the news, right? You only have to do it one night. You know what they're going to give you on the news? They're going to give you weather. And they're going to tell you about weather at the start, and then they're going to give you 7 minutes of weather. They're going to tell you it was 73 degrees in Northampton and 72 degrees in Amherst, but over in Leeds it was 74. And then they're going to tell you that tomorrow it's going to be 72, 74, and 75. And then they're going to tell you the barometric pressure, and no one in the history of the United States has ever known what barometric pressure is. And then they're going to tell you there's a weather front starting over in Japan, and if the wind blows the right way, we may have snow come December. But the fact of the matter is that 7 minutes of weather doesn't tell you anything beyond what you'd already know. And the fact is, that's the basic reality. We've culled out journalism in this country, and what we've left is a void filled by campaign ads. Because while all the other ads tend to go to smartphones and other ways and follow you on the internet, so when you log on, they tell you about the things you want to do. But TV ads are still there, funded by the richest people in America. And it's not a right-wing thing. It's not a Republican thing. It's right and left, Democrat and Republican, race to put as many ads as they can on TV. And Bob's told you about the ads, and it's a crisis. Because when you have a democracy where we've got the vote, but we don't have the information, we've broken the essential American construct. We've broken with that construct of 1791, where we said the people need to be informed for them to govern themselves. And so we end up in this situation where we have to revisit all of our media issues. Free Press, the group that Bob and I work with, does a tremendous job of this. Craig, Josh, Jesse, all these people who we've worked with in so many struggles, go to the website, look at some of the proposals they have, and then ask them why they're not even pushing harder. Because the fact of the matter is, what we have to do, we have to create an opening for journalism in this country. And that opening for journalism has to borrow from our own history, the recognition that we, the people, have the ability to create a free and functional press. It also has to borrow from every example around the world. When The Economist magazine rates the freest countries in the world, when they rate the most democratic countries in the world, The United States isn't number one or number two or number three or number four or number five. It's not even number 20. The countries that Economist magazine, Freedom House, other places rate as the freest countries in the world have the strongest public media in the world. In Slovenia, they pay $75 to $1 in the US per capita for public media. In Scandinavia, it's roughly 40 to 1. In Germany, it's roughly 20 to 1. And this creates a reality. There is a reality. Germany just had an election. 72% of the people voted. In America, 52% of the voting age population voted in our last presidential election. Norway, it's over 80%. The fact of the matter is we're creating a dysfunctional democracy where people don't have the information they need. So we have to change our journalism. We have to change our media and make it small-d democratic in the way this country has always been. But to get there, we have to recognize that we also have a bigger democracy crisis. We could go on about it forever, but the people in this region know well about it. The fact of the matter is that when money flows into politics and defines our democracy, it warps our democracy. It warps our democracy to neglect fundamental issues. And so we have to go back to Daniel Shays. We have to go back to the founders and say they were exactly right when they gave us the power to amend. The power to amend, which they used 10 times in the first 4 years for that Bill of Rights. Let us understand. It is time, brothers and sisters, to get over our fears and to embrace the core reality that Thomas Paine gave us. He said, never, ever wed one generation to the rules of the past. That every generation should be a founding generation. And if the Constitution is insufficient, let us amend it. Let us amend the Constitution of the United States to say corporations are not people. Money is not speech. We have a right to form a democracy where the vote matters more than the dollar. And don't stop there, brothers and sisters, because a Supreme Court that can say money is free to flow in our politics, but our Voting Rights Act isn't needed anymore in the form it was written. No, no, that's wrong. We need a constitutional amendment that says every American has a right to vote and a right to have that vote counted. And let's not stop there, brothers and sisters, because that Electoral College shouldn't be there. George Bush lost the 2000 election by 540,000 votes, and he became president because of the Electoral College. We've got to address these issues, and let us recognize that gerrymandering is wrong. It is wrong to create non-competitive districts. It is wrong that Massachusetts sends all Democrats to Congress. And it is wrong, it is absolutely wrong, that there are a bunch of states that send all Republicans to Congress. The fact of the matter is we are disenfranchising tens of millions of Americans by gerrymandering our districts. That's not one person, one vote. That is one politician drawing the lines that serve that politician. Let's break the lie, a constitutional amendment to ban gerrymandering of our congressional districts. I know. You're saying, this is so great. I love coming out to the Walt Whitman place and cheering with Mr. Nichols. That is lovely. I enjoy that very much. But I fear when I walk out the front door, as I walk down the lovely streets of Northampton, why, at some point, doubt might creep in. I might start to think, well, you know, it's kind of hard to amend the Constitution, 37 states and all this in the Congress. Why, I'm not sure this Congress is going to embrace constitutional reform. They're having a little bit of time paying their bills. And I understand the skepticism. But you know what? Any reform that somebody suggests that is possible, you shouldn't do. If somebody says, here, I've got an idea. This will be easy. Well, if it's easy, let the politicians do it or let them screw it up. But the bottom line is the job of reformers should be to do that which is hard, that which is impossible. That which is unimaginable, except by those who are the most disenfranchised. I'll close with this. 100 years ago in this country, if you looked out across the great plains of this United States, looked across this country, you would see a land where little 6- and 7-year-old girls ran out their front door in the morning and went not to a school, but to a factory, to a textile mill. And they would work as bobbin girls Their job was to go amidst the machines, and if a bobbin came off, to put a new bobbin on. The machines were working. The little girls, their fingers were so small, they could get the bobbin in there and change it. And that was great. The people that owned the factories, they thought that was the most wonderful thing imaginable, these little girls with their little fingers. But sometimes the machine kept whirling, and it would cut a little girl's finger off, or her hand. And the little girl, she'd be maimed for life, but maybe her friend made it. You know, the little girl that was lost, you know, that was okay because she wasn't a full-scale worker. You know, she wasn't really contributing to society. So the girl that did make it, though, and grew up of age, maybe she got a job in a silk factory or a shirt factory. Maybe she was working in a big city and she worked up on the top floor of a 10, 11-story building. Worked with other little girls who'd come from Italy and Ireland, Lebanon, black girls coming up from the south, Latinos coming to this country long before we talked about all the immigration reforms. They're all working in that mill up there on the 10th, 11th floor of the building and working hard 10, 12, 14, 15-hour days. And then when it catches on fire, they run to the door because they're 17, they're 18, they're 19 years old. They've got dreams. They've got hopes. They want to live. And the door is locked because the people who own that factory didn't want to let them go and take bathroom breaks during those 12 and 14-hour days. And so they must make the choice. Do they burn alive? Or do they jump to their death? And in New York City, on the streets around the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory, one body after another came out of those windows and fell till it was streets filled with dead girls. That was not Bangladesh. That was America 100 years ago. 100 years ago in this country, and we had no way to deal with it. We didn't respond to it. Because those girls couldn't vote. Those women couldn't vote. And if they could vote, they couldn't elect their U.S. Senate. Because we had an appointed U.S. Senate, not an elected U.S. Senate. So the Congress of the United States could not ever be fully responsive, even in the worst of situations, couldn't be responsive to the people. And we didn't have the ability to tax the wealthy and corporations in any kind of meaningful or progressive way. That was 100 years ago in this country. And you know what happened? The survivors, the women who didn't die, the girls who did grow up, they got together. They worked their 12, 14-hour days, and then they went to meetings at 10, 11 o'clock at night with immigrants, poorest people in this country, and they formed populist and progressive and socialist and radical movements, and they demanded fundamental change. They said, I don't want to tinker around the edges. I want the big thing. I want big change in this country. They demanded constitutional change. In 1910, everything I described was real. By 1920, in the United States of America, women had the right to vote. We had an elected United States Senate, and we had created a system where we could have progressive taxation, laying the groundwork for the New Deal and every progressive reform that came since then. And more than that, because of those great demands, we had begun to ban child labor. We'd begun to protect women in the workplace. We'd begun to draw the rough outlines of a trade union movement. We had begun to fundamentally change this country because we embraced the demand of constitutional reform rather than the compromise of tinkering around the edges. Brothers and sisters, there's only one question you have to ask yourself, because these are your grandparents and your great-grandparents. Are you less than they were? Are you insufficient to the demand of the American experiment? Because the American experiment demands that we fix it, that if something's not working, we make it right. And I believe the frustration, the chaos, the anger of this moment is the healthiest thing possible. Because our anger, our frustration demands that we rise up and make a fundamental change. Brothers and sisters, it is time for a new age of reform. Let us amend our Constitution to get money out of politics. Let us amend our Constitution to say that every American has a right to vote. Let's address the Electoral College. Let's address gerrymandering. We don't even have to do constitutional reforms to make real the promise of a free press. Let us get into the fight in a realistic and meaningful way, and the people will rise. 16 states have already formally demanded that the Constitution be amended to get money out of politics. 16 states have already done it. 500 communities have petitioned Congress to get money out of politics and to say corporations are not people. Money is not speech. We have a right to forge a functional democracy. These changes are happening, and we all need to be a part of it. Because if we are not, brothers and sisters, we will cede to the coming generations a country that is dramatically less than that which we inherited. The greatest blessing we inherited was the right to make this country better. Let us embrace it. Solidarity.